touching just...
Okay, hold on, man. Hey, you
know, no, like...
I'm still human now. Don't touch me, you know.
No, just like... no, like...
I got it, too. Yo, come on.
Not like that.
I know, but... It's getting like that, though. Like, you
know. No. But touching is a part of letting the person know that you are reaching out and having some affection. And not only that, you know, the first thing I know, most of you, when you saw that video, you told me, like, I want to give you a hug right now. And I felt that people know that the connection of hugging and touching and, of course it's a different touch when it's your husband, but, it has something to do with the healing process. I don't think you can go without, especially when you're like married, you can't go without touching that person and heal. I can't see it. I don't know how other people, I don't feel like you would have healed the right way.
Well, you know, sometimes, you don't have the strength to utter the word I need help, or the word
right.
I'm hurting, or the word that, you know, I need attention. And that, to me, that's where the body language has to come into play, because it's not always what a person says, is really what they don't say that you have to pay attention to. So, you know, the body language is very important, and I'm a touchy-feely guy. And sometimes I don't want to talk. I just want to hug. Sometimes I just want you to rub my head. And, you know, that.
I'm so tempted to do it right now, but I'm not going to do it.
I want to keep this video clean, right? You can't be doing all that. But, you know, I've been married. We've been married going on 15 years.
So, I got married when I was 2.
So how old am I then?
3. You got married when you was 3.
Okay.
So you would.
So it's not you, are you,
you're 18 and I'm 17.
Okay. Yeah, I can still go to jail though. But anyway.
With me being 17, you being 18?
I think you're underage.
Okay, so let me change.
So what it is is that you just have to embrace the process of healing. And that's in a nutshell. For me, when you embrace that, when you do more for others than you do for yourself, that all helps out with the healing process. When you continue to believe that something good is going to come out of any bad situation.
I'm just listening for Joe.
That's part of the healing process. And, you know, you just have to remember that if you are alive and living, there is hope for anything. For some people, it might not be a situation that you may have kids and you have to come to that realization. But you don't have to stop loving kids. Mm-hmm. You can still adopt. You can still embrace being a parent to someone. We're focusing on just like, you know, the aspect of kids, but that's in any loss. Maybe you lost a parent.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you could parent someone. Or you could go under someone and adopt them as your parent. You know, in other words, you don't have to stop embracing love.
Right.
You know,
right.
Oh, my mom is dead. I don't have a mom no more. No, there's a lot of people you can adopt as your mom that you could look up to, that you could be mentored under.
That they're looking for a daughter or a son. Like, you're not the only one that's, like, out there wanting that. And I've learned to, like, even pray that prayer. Like, God, if this is a void or this is something that I'm missing, send somebody to me that's, like, needing the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, there are people who want to mother a child that don't have one. And then there are sons, there are boys and girls, men and women, who want a parent. And what God will do is fuse those two people together. And you're like, man, this is like, this person birthed me.
In other words, it's the circle of life.
Right.
You know, it doesn't have to stop because somebody close to you has passed away. So in saying all that, I just want everybody to be encouraged and to understand that you can make it. you can make it. It's always someone going through something just as bad or worse than you are going through. And so you have to understand that if God allowed you to deal with it, he can get you out of it. And I just don't want you to feel like you're hopeless. You're not hopeless. You know, losing three kids is hard. Losing one kid is hard. Mm-hmm. Losing a child that you've actually seen, you know, out of the womb, mm-hmm. and then that child passes away is difficult. Losing a child that, I don't know if you know the story about Joseph, our son, but I'm going to say it really quick.
Oh, you know this is going to be long. I'm going to have to cut this off. And we're going to have to come back.
Why got to be long when I say it?
No, it's not long. Just want to see. Keep going then.
Basically, Joseph was a surprise. And
surprise!
When he came into the world, when she was with child in 2008.
Why do you have to say it like that? With child.
When she was pregnated in 2000.
Oh, wait, that's even worse. Say a different way.
When she was overshadowed by...
Well, hold on just a second. You keep talking. I'm going to just go check on Joe because I don't hear anything and he's been asleep for a while.
You know, she was high risk and she had to go through the process of what's called a cerclage. Cerclage is a medical process where they have to tighten or reinforce the cervix so when the baby grows, the cervix won't prematurely open up and then you lose the baby. And so we went through that process with Elijah. It was successful. Now she's pregnant again. And so first trimester, they said, we got to go through the process. Everything is healthy. And so we were celebrating. Wow. You know, and I was kind of making fun of her in a good way. I said, man, Melissa, look like you got twins up in you.
He kept saying that.
She was pretty big. She's a small woman. And, you know, I was like, she was pretty big, you know, in the stomach area. And so I'm like, I was,
in the stomach area?
In your stomach. And so I was joking with her. And so, you know, she told me to shut up, of course. And anyway, I was like, I'm just playing, you know. So
no, but you were for real.
Wednesday of that was Monday. Wednesday.
No, you told me even before that.
Okay. But Monday was when we went in for just a general checkup. Wednesday was the procedure. And so as she was having the procedure, mm-hmm. you know, gave her a kiss, everything was good. I get a call and the doctor told me that they had to stop the process, the procedure. I said, why? He said, because the umbilical cord was disconnected, which meant
The placenta.
I thought it was the...
No, the placenta the placenta had detached itself.
Okay. Thank you. So the placenta was detached.
Because that's all the nourishment. Meaning that
that's where the life.
Oxygen, everything.
You know, everything comes through that nourishment and oxygen, like she said. And so they had to stop the process. I said, well, can you reattach it? They was like, no, because of all the toxins and things like that. And it's been ruptured. And so they told us we have to stop the process.
They couldn't even do the cerclage because it was like, the placenta was blocking.
And so if there was any debris or any type of toxin left.
That would kill me.
It would kill her as well. So I couldn't believe it. I said, here we go again. Round three. And it's going to be really, really difficult now, Lord, because we already, you know, went through the valley with the other two. And now this. And so... But I collected myself and I said, okay, something's good is going to happen. All week we've been talking about miracles, expectation. And so they said, well, we got to stop the process. The good thing about all this was that we were at a Catholic hospital. And the code and ethics in a Catholic hospital is that if there's a heartbeat, they can't abort the baby.
Because for religious purposes, they believe it's still a soul.
So that was a chance for God to work. Mm-hmm. And so we prayed. And of course, you know, Melissa was devastated. I was too. But we kept praying and said, Lord, you know, something good is going to happen out of this. I don't know how.
It can't end like this.
I don't know when or what, but it got to happen. Because we've been praying all week for something great to happen. And so we went to the physician's office the next day. Mm-hmm. And he told us, look, we have to take the baby out because... it's slowly dying. And so you basically have less than 19% of...
Oh, he didn't say even like 10%.
No. He said 19.
I thought he said 5.
No, I heard him say 19.
Okay.
But 19 or 5, that's not a whole lot of
hope. But he said 19 and then the other doctor said.
But it's hope.
Right.
So... that's what I said. Where there's life, there is hope. So mm-hmm. he said, you know what I'm going to do real quick? I'm going to, you know, do a sonogram and, you
ultrasound.
Know, ultrasound. Mm-hmm. And so definitely you can see that the baby is dying. Right. Mm-hmm. So the doctor,
the specialist,
we just blurted that out. Okay.
Dr. E.
Okay. So he does the ultrasound and I'm telling you, I'm not lying. Melissa's my witness. He did the ultrasound, and so he heard the strong heartbeat of the baby.
Well, let me say this first. He said, now, I can do the procedure, the DNC, right now if there's no heartbeat.
Yeah, that's what he said.
He was like, let me do an ultrasound because yesterday the placenta had detached, and
so the baby is probably
dead by now.
Yeah.
This is what he's like, because it can't live without nourishment or oxygen for that amount of time.
I kid you not. Mm-hmm. Melissa's my witness. She wasn't drugged up or anything. She saw the same thing I saw. When he put that ultrasound device on the baby's hands did like this. And the doctor is African, so he looked. He said, "Did you see that? Did you just see what I saw? Did you just see that?" And we said, "Yes, we saw that." And so I said, "Hold up, that's right. Hope."
Right.
I said, "Hold up, I just saw what you saw. She just saw what you saw." I said, "That baby is alive,"
and
the heartbeat was like this. So I said, that's a strong heartbeat. I said,
it didn't sound like it was like, if you didn't, if it was like, or, boom.
Yeah.
Boom.
That brother was doing a cadence. And so I said, okay. I said, now you got me interested because now I know that there's purpose and we could do something, right? He said, well, you know, this is really bothering me, but.
He said this was the worst case, and he's been practicing medicine over 30 years, mm-hmm. maybe 40 years. He said that this is the worst case. No, the next to the worst case. He said the worst case that he had seen was someone with some, like, crazy cancer or something, mm-hmm. which really, does that make you hopeful? Like, no.
So in a nutshell, he said, okay, we're going to get a second opinion. And all that was a part of, you know, the hope of God, because it delayed the process.
Right. The second opinion actually was worse than his, though.
Yeah.
No. He got a second opinion right then and there. He sent the pictures. Remember, he mm-hmm. sent the pictures to another specialist that was a woman. I'm losing light. I'm going to have to, like, maybe put up our...
So the second opinion was basically, this is not good, and it won't be good. What's it be?
They sent us to another hospital. They sent us to another hospital because the hospital that we were at, the Catholic hospital, would not do a procedure like that. And there's Joe.
So we went to the other hospital, and they looked at everything, and they were like, okay, definitely, we're going to have to check this baby out. They did 72 pelvic and cervical ultrasounds.
It was
And 4D. Mm-hmm. And they said, yes, your wife is hemorrhaging really bad. We got to take this baby out because
JoJo,
she's not going to make it, and the baby won't make it. So I kept saying to Melissa, we kept saying to each other, we're not going to stop believing. We're going to keep believing that God's going to do something miraculous. We don't know what. And so I got to a point where the doctor at that point said, there's 0% chance of anything happening out of this situation. I said, doctor, I'm not going to give up. I'm going to keep believing. I know what you're saying, but I know the God that I serve. And I've seen a miracle happen before, and it's going to happen again in this situation. And so his assistant was like, well, you know, you just got to get, you know, got to deal with it. It's going to happen, blah, 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 blah.
Oh, she was horrible.
You know, and she was horrible, but I didn't expect her to understand. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm talking about. You have to hold on to the hope that you know God has given you, no matter what the naysayers, you know, say or do. You have to continue to believe that God can do whatever he wants to do for you or anybody else. I gave my wife a kiss on the forehead and I said, don't stop believing.
Well, tell them what they were getting ready to do. I'm setting up the lights. So they
were getting ready to basically take the baby out because she was hemorrhaging really bad. She was losing blood and the baby was losing blood.
Well, he was saying that they were.
And so if they didn't do the process, both my wife and the baby would have died. So I told her, don't stop believing. Gave her a kiss. I left. It was about 10 o'clock, 10:30 p.m. Went home. Before I went home, I had a conversation with God. I didn't have the conversation that people, you know, that have a church background would think that I had. Like, you know, Lord, I beseech you on today. I need you like never before. No, I was mad. And I told God, I said that I'm upset because not at you, but I'm upset that these people doubt your miraculous glory. And I'm upset because they think that all this that we're going through is just for naught. You know, basically, it ain't going to happen. And I know that you could do whatever you want to do. And I need you to show up because I believe in miracles. I say, Lord, it's not about whatever happens. It's in your perfect will. I already know that. I know a baby's going to come out of my wife at the end of 9 months. And so I stayed, you know, strong in believing that that was going to happen. Went home, took a hot shower, got some fresh clothes for my wife, and I was going to head back out to get her. Or not to get her, but to bring her clothing. And the phone rang. And it was like 12:05 the next morning. And I didn't want to answer the phone. And, you know, I said, okay, I'll just go ahead and answer the phone. When I answered the phone, it was the doctor. And the doctor started screaming at me. And he said, Forrest, Forrest. I said, yes, doctor, like, what's going on? And he said, you know, he explained to me what was happening. He said, we took the placenta out. I said, okay, successfully. We took the fetus out successfully. I said, okay, I already know that. You told me this was going to happen. Wait, Forrest, wait. Hold on. Wait. So I'm getting a little attitude like, okay, hold on, man. You're screaming at me like that. You know, he said, but something told me to put down my device. Mm-hmm. Now, he already took out the placenta. He already took out the fetus. And then the device helps clean out, vacuum mm-hmm. out the debris mm-hmm. that's left over. He said something told him to put the device down. Now, for those who have a church background, you know how we pray. Lord, tie the hands of the doctor. Lord, whatever you do, Lord, do something. Blind his eyes. Do something. Don't let him take that baby out. In the name of Jesus. You know. And so the funny part was he said, something told him, which I know it was God, to put his device down.
His name was Daniel.
Oh, don't say the name.
No, not the full name.
Okay. So his name was Daniel. Okay, so he said then something told him to look back on the monitor. And he did. So he looked back on the monitor and he said, Forrest. I said, yes. He said, I saw a wall of mucus. I said, okay. Forrest, on the other side of the wall, I saw another heartbeat. I said, okay. Forrest, on the other side of the wall, I saw a placenta. Forrest, there was another baby. Melissa had Melissa had another baby. She had twins, Forrest. We can save the baby. It's a miracle. I said, what? My eyes got big. I started crying. I said, Dr. Daniel, there was another baby. He said, yes, Forrest. In my 28 years of doing this, I've never seen this happen before. We can give her the cyclage now. This is not after 9 months. This is in the first trimester.
No, we were in the second.
No, this was you were maybe 3.5 months.
No, the specialist was telling us that he can't do a cyclage until after I'm out of my first trimester to make sure that it's not, it was, if any defects were wrong with the baby, my body would do it, expel it on its own.
It was like 4 months, which is still early, because normally if there's a twin, you don't find out until, you know.
They know early with twins.
Okay, well.
That, what was crazy, I think, was one, they said it's a hiding, like it's, one was hiding.
But first of all, normally you don't take something out and then there's something left inside. Mm-hmm. That doesn't happen. And both doctors admitted that in their profession, the way that they're taught is that once it's confirmed that there's death, mm-hmm. there's no turning back. There's no second guessing or let's double check. It's one and done. So if he would have taken that device and go back in there, Joseph Emmanuel, God be with us,
Jesus,
would not be here. So it just it lets us to know that, you know, not only does prayer changes things, but you have to have hope. Mm-hmm. You have to embrace hope. And you have to know that that's our testimony. Might not be your testimony, but I guarantee you, anybody watching this has had something good come out of a bad situation. Don't think that because it's bad, it's going to be bad all the time. Because you might say, well, you know, I've been in a situation where I don't have a baby daddy, or, you know, I was molested, I was raped, something crazy happened. And, you know, that's horrible. I get it. But always remember, something good can take place even out of a bad situation.
Especially if it says all things work together for good, that are called those that love God and are called according to his purpose. I feel like, you know, even with Brooklyn, I felt like, you want to go to daddy? I feel like I could have said, you know, oh, my baby is gone. First of all, it took us, it was 6 years? No, it was 7 years. Was it 7 years or 6 years with Brooklyn? In 2010, it was 8 years,
yeah,
right?
The first baby was 2004. So from 2004 to 2008 was 4 years. And then after Brooklyn, it was 2 more years.
Right.
And so basically, in a nutshell, you know, you have to keep fighting. Life is a fight.
Right.
And I'm going to tell you on record that this brother right here, God just put it in my spirit not to give up on him, because all the odds were against him and us. And that's why you have to remember that, you know, God is in control of your situation. Whether you believe in God or not, it doesn't even matter, because he's still in control, whether you believe on him or not. And I'm just telling you as a witness that you have to stay encouraged.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to, you know, continue to keep hope alive in your own life and keep walking in your faith that something good is going to happen. You know, everybody else is getting blessed, and I feel like I'm the last of the Mohicans. You know, I'm on the bottom of the totem pole. Don't speak, you know, negative thoughts in your life. Say, you know what? Mine is on the way. Walk in it.
He's saving the best for last. You have to look at the glass being half full than half empty. And that's what I was going to say in terms of even with Brooklyn. I could have said, oh, you know, I lost my baby, everything. I knew that. But then what I also had to think about is that, first of all, we had difficulty in getting pregnant. We got the first time, I didn't even get that far. So I thought about it. I was like, man, if God can take me 6 months, he can take me 9. That's only 3 more months. And I had to think that way because, you know, believe it or not, depression, spiral it into like a depression, and just, it's not good for you, it's not good for your body. So
it's not good for your spouse.
No,
it affected our marriage, and we almost got divorced over depression.
Over the first one. Brooklyn, yeah. I feel like God used that, birth and that death to actually, either something like that, either it's going to bring you closer together or it's going to tear you apart. And I feel like that one taught us how to, I feel like the first pregnancy, it was like, what about me? This is what I'm feeling. I'm going through this. I think with Brooklyn, it was more like, we kept making sure that we were doing those daily check-ins, though sometimes even a couple of check-ins throughout the day. You good? You okay? It was not about how I felt. It was like how he felt through it. And I was like, you know, how you doing, baby? You all right? Okay, it's bothering you? Let's talk. And I felt like talking through it was our biggest healing, was like making sure, you know, I'm just going to be real. Talking through it, there were times where there was no talking involved. It was about healing through talk. Then it was healing through touch. Then it was, you know, there's that time that you actually have to come together, and it's about making love. I mean, that's just how it is, because it's no plain way to say that, because when it comes to healing, you have to have the physical touch. You have to have the emotional part. You have to have the psychological part. You have to have somebody to talk to. But if you have somebody to talk to, and that's why it's important, it was important for me to talk to him and not another man, is because now I'm feeding those emotions that now I want to act out physically with someone else. So I didn't even think about that until now, but I needed to make sure that I was directing my feelings, my emotions, how I felt towards you. So I was actually giving that attention to the right person and not somebody over to the side, because I feel like that happens a lot.
It's easy to do that because, first of all, for those who've been married, you know that when things are on the rocks emotionally at home, you have to vent. And it's nothing wrong with venting, but it is something wrong when you're venting to someone that's not your spouse.
That's right.
That doesn't have the same investment of your relationship or your well-being. Don't get me wrong. You can talk to people who are good people, who mean well, who have something good to say, but it's on a different, higher lunar level when it's your spouse. If I could talk to somebody, whether it's male or female, more than I could talk to my spouse, something is wrong.
Something is wrong.
Because she's my helpmate, I'm her helpmate, and that did you just dub
it? Yes. Stop.
A nasty McNugget. And so, and I think you need your diaper change.
You think so?
I smell something. Sweet. If you don't embrace healing, you'll never be healed. If you don't embrace strength, you'll never be strengthened. And so you have to embrace it. And sometimes embracing it hurts the most because it brings all those feelings back, all those memories back. But when you embrace it, now you can work on it. You know, you have to be broken in order to be fixed. You have to admit that you're broken. If you keep saying, I'm good, I'm straight, everything is fine, you'll never be fixed.
The biggest thing is like honesty. And it's okay to it's okay to know that you're broken. And the great thing about knowing that you're broken is knowing that if you know that you're broken, you know when you're healed. I feel like, you know, there's the healing process that has to happen. But we could keep talking about, we can go on and on. I feel like that there's so many different facets of healing that.
What?
Facets?
Yeah, I said facets, and not you.
Oh,
bite.
You did?
You know I said facets.
No, and I didn't bite off your word. I bit off Webster's word, okay? But anyway, there's so many different
nuances.
There's a plethora of different things. Okay. There's a plethora of different things that we could talk about in this video, but we're just going to end it here. We know that there will probably be a part two. And I just want to thank my husband, first of all, for coming on, because it is extremely hard to talk about something like this and not go through the emotions of reliving something.
And oh, by the way, not that I didn't want to talk about it, but
you had to be ready for it.
It still hurts, right? Because, right, you know, it's a part of you. But right, talking is one of the best, being communicable is one of the best ways to overcome anything.
Right.
Once you talk through it, talk through it, you can get through it. And then you start believing in what you're saying.
Right.
And words itself help out with healing. When you say when you say kind, positive words, mm-hmm, we're going to get through this. God's going to bless. We're going to get victory. We're going to have a positive life. You're speaking your own remedy to your healing.
And you have to speak things into existence.
You have to speak it. You have to believe it. You know, will you get upset? Of course. Will you get frustrated? Of course. But you have to believe that it can happen. And it will happen. Not just it can, but it will. So with that said, we thank you all for your time. We're hoping that something was said to enlighten you and to encourage your hearts.
This is like hope for those that have, like, you know, into a new year. You know, this is like hopefully this is like a refreshing of a new beginning, of new hope, of new beginnings. So yeah, that's pretty much what we wanted to talk about. Thanks so much for you guys tuning in, and make sure down in the comments below, we are both going to read them together. Let me know,
please be nice in your comments. I've been noticing some of the comments have been a little bit,
you know, I only get a few people that, and that's not, you know, everybody was very, very, very kind in the dealing with depression and death.
I'm gonna be honest with you, I'm joking when I said that, because, you know, at the end of the day, your comments are your opinion, and we have to embrace good and bad. I'm not tripping, really. But in the same token, on a serious note, I hope that something was said to help somebody. And that's all we're trying to do, is just come from a realistic standpoint that goodness can happen.
Right.
If you believe that it can
happen. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Don't forget to give it a thumbs up. Please subscribe if you hadn't already. And make sure you put a comment down below. Let us know how you're going to refresh and renew and have new hope in 2017. And if there's anything that you can encourage someone else with, we here as a community here on the channel, we read each other's comments. It's just not me. It's just not going to be Forrest that's reading it. Someone else might be helped by what you say. So you all had some very encouraging things that you talked about on the last video. So make sure you comment down below. Or if you're going through anything that you would want us to maybe talk about in another video, or even if you just want us to pray about, let us know if you need a part two.
Joseph, get at your nose. What are you doing, man?
Stop. Oh, God. Please comment.
That's her child.
This is child.
Oh, no, I'm joking, homie. I'm joking. You're my child, too, baby.
Look at him. Oh, my goodness.
I'm sorry, Joe. My bad.
Please subscribe if you hadn't already, and we will see you in the next video. Love you guys. Bye.
God bless y'all.